The Malaga Cove Homeowners and the Lanada Bay Homeowners Association welcome you tonight. We're so glad you're here to learn all about the drought and about how you can reduce water usage at your home. And my name's Jill Shoemaker. I live here in Malaga Cove, and I'm representing the Malaga Cove Homeowners. And my fellow organizer is Reggie Ju from the Lanada Bay Homeowners. And we've had a great time putting all this together for you, so we hope you enjoy it. Late last month, we were contacted by an organization called the South Bay Cities Council of Governments, and we're reaching out to homeowners associations saying, we want to help put on presentations to your membership about water usage. And so they sent that to the Malaga Cove Homeowners and the Lanada Bay Homeowners, and we thought, okay, let's do this. And then we thought, let's do it together instead of having two separate. So we normally often work kind of separately as organizations, but it was really fun working together this time to do something for both our groups. So that's why we're all here tonight. It's come to pass. Thank you so much to the City of PVE for offering the City Council chambers at no cost to us tonight. It's very expensive to rent space at schools or libraries, and this is great. So thank you so much. Tony, I think, is in the back, our city manager, Tony Dallerbrook. And as you can see, we are videotaping this event. And so it's very important you turn off your cell phone. Also, it's very important that over the course of the evening that you not chat with people next to you or even whisper, because the microphones in the room are fairly sensitive. And this videotape will be made available to all the people who couldn't be here tonight in both of our associations at Malaga Cove and in Lanada Bay. But it also likely will be made available to others in PVE and perhaps others on the peninsula or even beyond. So we want to have a really high quality videotape of this. Now, everybody was given cards when they came in. Please jot down any of your questions about water usage. If something comes to you when you hear the speakers, write it down. Send it to the right-hand side of the room, the end of the aisle, and every 5 or 10 minutes, I'll come up and kind of like collect up the cards and bring them to Reggie, and he'll get them all organized so that we ask all your questions at the end. So we have several speakers, so they'll all be asked at the end. He'll know how to direct them to the correct panelists and so forth. So I think that's it, and I would like to present Reggie, who has a few things to say about the evening.
Thank you, Jill. I appreciate it, and it was fun working with you as well. So, what are we doing here tonight? What are we going to do? Okay, so we're going to try to get through a few introductory comments here as quickly as possible and get into the meat of the presentation. So we've got two major. I'm sorry. Oh, okay. So we've got a couple of presentations. First, we have West Basin Water District talking about where the water comes from, what the water situation is in California. Why are we here having this conversation? For those of you that are as confused as I was, West Basin Water District is a public agency that wholesales water to the various water companies. And in our case, that's California Water Service Service Company. And Cal Water then has the distribution systems, the metering, the pipes, and the maintenance and the billing to get that water from West Basin over to your home. So, Harold and Ron will be talking about that, and then Susan will get up and talk about the water allocations that you're currently starting to see on your bill. So you're going to see a bill that says you have so many CCFs. Susan will explain what that means, and she'll talk a little bit about tricks that you can do to conserve water to meet that allocation. And then there's going to be some questions about what if you can't meet those allocations, and so we'll talk about that as well. Probably the largest user of water, maybe the second largest user of water in the city, is the city itself. So Sherry Rep is here to talk about what you're going to see changes in your neighborhood, because the city itself is going to have to change and adapt to the new allocations as well. So you're going to see some changes in the city, and Sherry will talk about that. And then we really wanted to hold a lot of time at the end for questions and answers, and so all of the speakers are going to be form a panel so that you can get your questions answered. There's a lot of folks up here, and let me just do a really quick introduction. You've met Jill and me. Grace is with the South Bay Cities Council government over there. And Harold is on the board of directors of West Basin. Ron is with West Basin. Susan is a conservation coordinator with Cal Water, and she has her colleague Dana here as well. Sherry is a director of planning and building for the city of PVE. And then there's Marlene. Marlene is sitting over here. Marlene, many of you in Lanai Bay particularly would know Marlene. She's a landscape designer. She lives and works in Lanai Bay. She is very active in some of the things that we're doing in Lanai Bay in terms of initiatives being sponsored by the Homeowners Association, for example, Beautify Lanai Bay and Beach Restart. So she's very aware of the issues with landscaping and what that what the implications are. Many of us, particularly in Lanai Bay, to maybe a lesser extent in Malaga Cove, but as you go up the hill into Monte Malaga, there is a lot of use of water for irrigation. And so if you have any questions about things you can do to reduce your irrigation load, write it down and we'll let Marlene address those. One last thing I wanted to say is many of you, when you RSVP'd for this, you did it through an email account that we set up specifically for this meeting. That's the pvewater@gmail.com. We're going to leave that active for some time. If you have questions and suggestions, if you're not happy about something, send us an email and we'll see what we can do to help you. Okay?
Thank you. Well, my name is Grace Farwell, and I am here on behalf of the South Bay Cities Council of Governments. And I actually feel like I've come home. When I was a little girl, I actually lived here in Palos Verdes Estates and even went to Valmonte Elementary School. So that, I'm kind of dating myself on that one since it's no longer a viable elementary school right now. But I'm here representing, and then also my children have gone through Palos Verdes School. So Farwell was my maiden name, Granger is my married name, and so many of you may know my kids because they actually did play soccer and, as I said, went to high school here. But they did go to Peninsula High School, not PV High School. But I'm here, as I mentioned, representing the South Bay Cities Council of Governments. And how many of you have heard of the Council of Governments? Okay. We are a joint powers authority of the 16 cities that make up the South Bay. So from the Palos Verdes Peninsula, the four cities in this area, all the way up to Inglewood, and all the beach cities, and as far east as Carson. And then our board of directors are made up of the elected officials from each of the cities. So currently, our chairperson is your mayor, Jim Goodhart. So, and we're very involved in looking at, each city has individual things that they do, but collectively, we look at things as a sub-region. And we are a local government partnership with Edison and the gas company, and we've also brought in West Basin Municipal Water District as a partner as well. And so that's why we are here tonight to really talk about some of the water issues. So it gives me great pleasure now to introduce Director Harold Williams with West Basin Municipal Water District. Harold was recently elected to the Board of Directors in November of 2014, and he covers the Division 1, which includes Palos Verdes area, the four cities here, as well as Carson. And so Director Williams is a civil engineer by training, and he's been involved in many different organizations. He's very much a volunteer as well with the Lions Club. And most recently, well, I guess not most recently, but a few years ago, he was on council for the city of Carson as well. So tonight, I'm pleased to introduce Director Williams.
Thank you very much, Grace. Good evening, everyone. I am a civil engineer and water resources manager by profession, but I am a public servant by application. And I'm here tonight as a board member at West Basin, but I'm not here to bring you any new information. I'm here to really assist Ron, who is going to reinforce what you already know, that you must conserve water. And we suggest that you not fret over this, because all you can do is all you can do. And if you're doing all you can do, that's wonderful. And we can learn a lesson from the drought and the weather. We could all do that. They pay no attention to criticism. Basically, I'm here to give you some information about a proposed project, which will be the first project to bring recycled water to the peninsula. And that's going to be at your golf course here at the Palos Verdes Golf Course. Now, we have a project that's a collaboration of West Basin, the city, and the golf course. And this project consists of bringing in an 8-inch diameter recycled water line, a purple line, that will start at approximately at North High School and come up the hill. Now, in order to get that water up the hill, we're going to have to push it up the hill. And in order to do that, we have to have a pump station. And today, I'm happy to report to you that the Board of Directors, West Basin, has approved the general manager signing an agreement with the consulting firm who's going to find us the real estate that we need to build our pump station on. And so that's a very important constituent piece of this project, because without the pump station, guess what? No water. The estimated cost of this project is about $7.3 million. That's the way it is. Infrastructure projects are not cheap, but they're very important to us, and we want them. And we definitely want this one because the city has indicated a strong support for the project. Your mayor has been there keeping our feet to the fire that we do what we need to do to make sure that this project stays as a high priority in our capital improvement program, and we're working on the source of funding for the project. Now, we have project partners, like I indicated. Southern California has skin in the game. They're going to put in $1.6 million. Palos Verdes Estate is putting in $2.6 million that they hope to get through a grant. And the rest of the money comes through to you by way of West Basin, $3.1 million that we're planning to put into the project for, and we hope to get that through a grant. So it would be no cost to the taxpayers, sort of. But you're going to be paying with money that you've already spent, so you won't have to spend any additional money. So as I indicated, we're off and running. Today we got the key piece in line, the commitment to hire the consultant to find us the real estate that we need to build the pump station. Okay? So with that, I want to leave you with this, that water conservation is an attitude. It's a state of mind. Motivation is what gets you started, but it's habit that keeps you going. Have a good evening, everyone. And Ron Wuthermuth here, smooth-talking Ron, is going to deliver the message to you. He's going to give you what you might call the ugly and the bad, and then he's going to close with the good. Ron.
It's a pleasure to be here tonight. As Director Williams said, I'm going to kind of hopefully get you in a mindset where permanent conservation is indeed a habit. Next slide, please. We are in a drought. The governor asked us all to reduce 25, and in this particular place, 36%. But I'm not going to talk about the drought, because I think Susan can give you more information about the drought and how you have to deal with it. Next slide. This is what I want to talk to you about. I've been in the water industry for 20 years. I teach classes on water. I've studied water for 20 years. And what I'm worried about is signs of increased water scarcity. Next slide. More and more we see studies coming out saying we're going to have a drier future. Next slide. There is a global water crisis you're all aware of, I'm sure. 2 to 4 million people die every year. A child dies every 14 seconds. 80 countries can't feed themselves. This is only going to get worse. Next slide. They did a recent survey of all the water managers in the United States, and they are predicting water shortages in the future. Eastern United States are having the problems that we've been dealing with for 2 decades. Interestingly enough, 5 years ago, the governors of the Great Lakes states formed a compact and said no other state can take water out of the Great Lakes. They were envisioning a pipeline coming from California. Next slide. 2 prime ministers of Canada have said the same thing. Next slide, please. Groundwater is a very important source of water, and throughout the world, and especially in this state, we are taking more water out, more well water out of the ground and not replacing it. Next slide. Climate change. There's a degree of uncertainty with climate change. Next slide. But there are some things we know for sure. We will eventually lose our snowpack, and we use the most water in the summer, and normally we get that water from the snowpack. And if it's going away, when we need the water the most, we're going to have to find a new supply. And of course, temperature means more evaporation. Next slide. I love it. We're starting to see people negotiate over sewer water. Every time you have a city downstream from another city, the downstream city is drinking the clean sewer water from the upstream city. And let's see, we live south of Sacramento, Modesto, Fresno, and there is one thing that does leave Las Vegas. Next slide. When we get through this drought, you'll be assured there'll be another one. But more importantly, recent studies have shown that the 20th century was either the 3rd or 4th wettest century in the last 4,000 years. That means the century in which we built our huge infrastructure that moves all the water from the north to the south in this state and from the Colorado River to here was produced in a wet century. What happens if we return to a dry century? And there's been tree ring studies done in Southern California where there have been between 150 and 200 year droughts. And we're only in our 4th year of this drought. Next slide. We're going to add 10 million people to the state of California and 4 million people to the rest of the Colorado River states that all depend on the Colorado River, which, by the way, for decades has not delivered any water to the ocean because it's all used up. Next slide. The water that comes from north to south comes through a place called the Sacramento-San Joaquin Bay Delta, and that was basically a swamp. And after the Gold Rush, immigrants moved into the swamp, diked it up, created 60 islands of agriculture, and unfortunately, all the faults in San Francisco dead-ended into this swamp. So there could be an earthquake. Of course, they only happen every 27 years. But if it happened tomorrow, which it could, all those levees give way and the water quality would be very much destroyed. Next slide. Oh yeah, there's a big movie coming out about the San Andreas Fault. Our channels that bring water down here cross the San Andreas Fault 32 times. In fact, Metropolitan Water District of Southern California, who imports all the water from the Colorado River in Northern California, 10 years ago built a new reservoir in Hemet called Diamond Valley Lake, and that provided 6 months' supply should an earthquake sever the canals. It's down to 2 months right now. Next slide. A couple studies done on the Colorado River. You know, 7 states depend on the Colorado River. California is one of them. One study said that Lake Mead will never be full again. Now, if you've been watching the newspaper, Lake Mead is at the lowest level it's been since it was first filled. And Las Vegas is spending $1.5 billion to build another tunnel into Lake Mead because they think the first two will be high and dry. And the other study says that the seven states that depend on the Colorado River will be the next 1930s Dust Bowl with climate change. Next slide. We have a new customer in the water business. We used to provide water for farms and cities. Now we're returning water back to the environment. And a big case, a significant case of that, is Los Angeles is now leaving water back in the Owens Valley to moisten the rivers and lakes. And they leave enough water back there now to meet all the needs of the city of San Francisco for a year. Okay, next slide. So the solution is basically all of the water agencies in Southern California are making local drought-proof supplies. Next slide. Carlsbad, San Diego, about to turn on a 50 million gallon a day desal plant. Next slide. Orange County is about to turn on a 100 million gallon sewer water, indirect drinking water project in Orange County. Next slide. Out in Chino, the dairies contaminated the groundwater basin. They're taking that water out, putting it through reverse osmosis, and reusing it. Next slide. Los Angeles is going to do the same thing in San Fernando Valley. Next slide. West Basin's version is we recycle water, we conserve water, and we've been investigating ocean water desal. We're going to double our recycling, double our conservation, and when the time is right, we'll have all the technology we need to safely take water out of the ocean. Next slide. I'm very excited about our recycling program because we have in El Segundo, and shame on you if you've not been to our plant in El Segundo, the only one in the world that makes five types of water out of wastewater or sewer water, okay? We make three waters that are so pure we have to add minerals back to them to move them. We make one water that if you go to the grocery store and buy distilled water, it has 60 parts minerals. We make a water for Chevron that has four. Awesome. Next slide. On our conservation program, we're focused on the outside. We built ocean-friendly gardens or native plant gardens around our area, and we have classes to help you take some of your lawn and convert it to a California-friendly garden, which, after a year and you establish those plants, you never need to water them again. Next slide. And this is just the technology we've been experimenting with to protect the ocean with ocean water desal. It's basically a wedge wire screen that protects all the adult fish, all the juvenile fish, and all the mature larvae, which is the future of the ocean. Next slide. By creating local supplies, the largest lift of water in the world by height and volume is over the Tehachapi Mountains to bring water here. So these local supplies everybody's creating saves energy, and we're producing extremely high quality water. With that, I'd like to pass the baton, I think.
To me?
Why not? Susan.
Thank you, Ron. That was a lot to take in. That's a lot of information, a lot of facts. Ron, like he said, he lives and breathes water. My name is Susan Cordone. I work for California Water Service. I am a conservation coordinator. And as Grace mentioned, I've brought my colleague Dana Rasmussen to join me. She is part of our new drought response team. And we have been able to add some additional resources from within our own company to help the drought response efforts to help in a variety of ways. And so I couldn't be more thrilled to have some help and to be able to come to community meetings like this more often, because I think that this is important. We have a marketing campaign. We're mailing things out. Information out. We've got quite a variety of ways that we are communicating with our customers, but I personally believe that this is one of the most important ways. So after the end of our presentations, you'll have the opportunity to share your concerns and your comments, and we'll do the very best we can with the information that we have available. If we cannot answer your question, I brought a large stack of business cards, and I'm happy to connect with you afterwards. So this is basically a version of a presentation that we presented throughout all 24 of our California Water Service districts. We did a presentation that was pertinent to each district that we provide water to. And so go ahead and go to the next slide. And the next. So we are going to talk a little bit about the recent developments. Everything, even though we are in the fourth year of this drought, a lot has happened very quickly. And so I will go over those developments with you pretty quickly, and then I will get into an area where I talk about the Cal Waters Water Shortage Contingency Plan, as well as the conservation tools that are available to homeowners and businesses in our community here. And I didn't have to travel very far to get here, although I don't have kids in the school system here. I'm just in Redondo Beach, so. And our office is in Torrance, so we're definitely neighbors. And I'm pretty sure my high school played your high school. So we'll have an opportunity at the end, as mentioned, for question and answers. Go ahead, please. So this last April 1st, the executive order basically stated that we are in a continued state of emergency, talked about the mandatory statewide water use reduction in potable water of the 25% compared to 2013's water use. And we'll talk a little bit more about the different tiers of that and how that came into play. The 25% statewide water use reduction has been mandated by the governor to be completed by the end of February 2016. So we have our work cut out for us. Many of us have already been conserving, and I'll talk a little bit about how that plays into the percentage reduction. Ron mentioned too, we've got the summer months coming. We're used to being able to live our lives normally, irrigate regularly, and we will have to make some adjustments under the circumstances. Go ahead. So May 5th, the State Water Resources Control Board issued their regulations regarding the prohibited uses of water. I will go through all of those individually. Also mandated the requirement to reduce our water use by the 25%, and they came up with a regulation that was based on the average water use from June to September 24th water use. That's where we come up with the district-wide averages, and we can talk a little bit about that as well. Go ahead. So the reduction tiers, as mandated by the governor, I mentioned there were 25%, but there was a lot of talk about how the disparity in water use throughout all the regions in the state of California. And so this tier structure was established by the State Water Resources Control Board. And in the Palos Verdes Peninsula area, we have larger lots. There's differences, of course, from our neighbors like myself in Redondo, but we are in tier 9 here. Go ahead. The Palos Verdes residential gallons per capita per day is 255, which of course brought us into the ninth tier. Go ahead. Just to give you an idea of some comparable cities that are also in the ninth tier, you can just take a quick glance here. It also indicates the gallons per capita per day on a residential side. Go ahead. So the reduction requirement, is 36%, but we were fortunate, if you could use that term, but 4% reduction was achieved in 2014. So that helps the cause a little bit, but not enough to get us to where we can feel comfortable yet. Go ahead. This water shortage contingency plan, you may have read about it in the mailer going out to the home, or you're all in HOAs, so I'm not sure about how the communication was disseminated. We can talk to Reggie about that afterwards, but it did become effective. We are governed by the California Public Utilities Commission, and our water shortage contingency plan became effective, June 1st. However, we have had a water shortage contingency plan on our books for many years now. It's a section inside of our urban water management plan, and this is You can review it, is online on our website, and you can take a look at it there if you're interested in reading the entire plan. It's quite extensive. Go ahead. So the prohibited uses of water, of course, the application of water to outdoor landscapes in a manner that causes runoff, such as the water flows onto adjacent property, non-irrigated areas, private and public walkways, roadways, parking lots, or structures. So this is runoff. This is more often than not irrigation runoff, typically. Go ahead. The use of a hose, you can see in the photo there that this person is very, well, just not thinking, obviously. Yes, they're wasting water. They do not have a hose shutoff nozzle that has a automatic, just like we've all seen before. We do have these in our conservation kits that are free to the public, free to our customers, I should say, not to the entire public. You have to be a Cal Water customer. But you can ask for these, and they are a part of our conservation kit. And in an HOA, the preference is if there's a full need for the entire property, I would love to deal with your property managers or just get all the numbers together, basically, to help me out. Because we do fill those kits right down here in our Torrance office. Excuse me. The application of water to driveways and sidewalks. You know, what's missing here is a picture of a person actually standing out hosing down their driveway. That is no longer acceptable. It is a prohibited use of water. Go ahead. The use of water in a fountain or other decorative feature, except where the water is part of a recirculating system. You rarely see any fountains anymore that are not recirculating, so typically you would see the fountain is utilizing recirculating water. Go ahead. The application of water at outdoor landscapes during and within 48 hours after measurable rainfall, which is a tenth of an inch. Go ahead. And irrigation with potable water, our drinking water, outside of newly constructed homes and buildings that is not delivered by drip or micro spray systems. That's for new irrigation. And our irrigation restrictions are 3 days per week. No watering between 8 a.m. and 6 p.m. The exemptions are utilizing drip systems, which are becoming very popular, micro spray, and hand watering, which is interesting. Go ahead. Additionally, you must fix leaks within your control within 5 business days of notification. Ideally, we would like you to, if it's something that you can call us about, to shut off your main, whatever you have going, we certainly want to hear about it right away. We'd like for you to get it fixed right away, if at all possible, within your control. Okay? And then we've noticed, I'm sure I've been to restaurants lately, and they are not bringing us water unless we ask for them. That is a prohibited use of water. And in hotels and motels, I know you don't have too many up here, but there is signage. I'm seeing, I travel quite a bit for our company, and most of the hotels that I'm seeing are putting placards and information up about choices that we now have to not have our linens laundered on a daily basis. So, and I noticed driving up here that water has been reduced in our medians. That is because it is now a prohibited use of water. We are not able to water medians if they have ornamental turf. And so, you know, coming up here, we've got a gorgeous area with ornamental turf, and I'm certain that that is the case as to why the water has been reduced outside. The city or the state doesn't want to lose trees, so we need to keep the trees alive. We need to make sure that if folks are not irrigating their turf, that they're placing water opportunities on the trees to keep the trees alive some way. And then no filling or refilling of ornamental lakes or ponds except to sustain existing aquatic life. And then here's where we get into the enforcement measures. Our first violation typically would be a written notice, and which is a letter or a door tag on your door, and then the opportunity to install real-time measurement device on the on your meter, which is basically a real-time measurement device for the water use. Second violation, after verification, a Cal Water representative would go out to investigate and see a violation, and then we would have the opportunity for a written notice and the option to assess a $50 surcharge. This is part of our water shortage contingency plan that was recently approved by the California Public Utilities Commission, whom we are governed by. Third violation, again, after verification and a additional written notification, the opportunity to assess a $100 surcharge. And fourth, written notice authorization to install a flow restrictor on the customer service line, as well as subsequent, we certainly would never want to, we would have the authority and the opportunity to discontinue water service. And certainly we would not want it to get to that point. Our goal is to help educate. That's why we're coming to homeowners meetings. That's why we're holding public meetings. That's why we are available. We have initiated a drought call center. So we've got folks on staff that are part of our team. They are not new hires. They are taking calls from the public to help address concerns. And these are a group of very knowledgeable folks. So water budgets basically is a individual water budget based on your water use on a month-to-month basis in 2013, okay? And the reduction requirement is a 36%, but keeping in mind that you've already got the 4%, so keep working at it. And I will also be talking about ways that your HOA can utilize our programs. West Basin has a variety of programs as well, and we typically partner on a lot of them. Go ahead. So I mentioned that you can go online to, you would need an account number, so you would have to have your HOA share that information with you and perhaps have a additional meeting to discuss how you as a group of individuals are going to optimize your water savings requirements. Go ahead. So this is just on an individual meter situation, just gives you an indicator of sample 2013 usage in CCFs. One CCF is equal to 748 gallons of water. And that is noted on the bill. Our meters are in metric, so we have it in 100 cubic feet. So this gives you an indicator of what use occurred in sample, of course, in September of 2014, and then a requirement water budget for the current year of 2015 based on 2013's water use. Go ahead. Oh, before we go, the State Water Resources Control Board established a minimum water budget, and in an individual single-family residential property, that's the red line. They ascertained that a 55-gallon per person per day would be a minimum water budget. And so that comes into play if folks, you know, had a few people living in their home in say 2013, and now they've got all the relatives moved in. I mean, there are, you know, situations obviously in life where we have folks coming and going, moving in and out of our homes. So this minimum water budget has been established by the state board. Go ahead. So for water budgets, the California Public Utilities Commission, again, who govern us, part of our water shortage contingency plan was, okay, well, we can set these budgets, but how are we going to be able to enforce them? So in this case, we are able to charge a surcharge for any unit used over your allocated budget. And that surcharge is not to exceed $10. In this particular area, it would be $9.54 for every unit over the budgeted amount for your property. And then customers on our low-rate income assistance program are charged half of that, and the surcharges are included on the customer's water bill. So something that is unique to Cal Water is the opportunity for banking. So besides the fact that we do go up and down in our water use, if you've got a month that your water use has is lower than your budget for that month, you can basically take those extra units and they are held for you in a bank, just kind of like rollover minutes. And so those banked units are available to you at a subsequent, they do not go back, they are not retroactive, but they would be available for future use if you've got a month that all the relatives came to town and you found yourself a couple of units over. So that's how that would work out. And so the appeal process, this is a very popular topic. We, as of June 1st, our customer's call center became effective, the drought response call center. We have folks that are already applying for appeals based on some of the things that we've already talked about. You've had changes to your household, the folks living in your household numbers. Perhaps you need additional units for health and safety for your home. You've got an infant that you're doing laundry constantly. There are a variety of reasons. I would encourage you, if you felt that you needed to make any adjustments to your budget, to pursue the appeal process. And that is basically online, a 5-minute process. And if you are not if you're not savvy on the internet and you need some help, you call our drought response call center and we would print an application for you and mail it to your home. If that's something that you would need, we're happy to help. Business or economic needs, those obviously are for businesses that require water to sustain their business, and so we will listen to their concerns, of course, through the appeals process, excuse me. And then also, if you've already experienced significant long-term water reduction goals, you switched out your high water use plant material years ago, we would like to know about that through the appeals process. If it's, if it's in the last 5 years or so and you want to share that with me and you've taken I'm not on the appeals board. If you want to share that with our company, we would like to know the steps that you've taken. If you changed out a weather-based irrigation control, or gotten a new controller. So go ahead. So I'll touch pretty quick on it because I know that there are a lot of questions, but I want to share with you some of the programs that we do have available. We've got toilets on rebate, washers on rebate, weather-based irrigation controllers on rebate, free sprinkler nozzles. Water use efficiency evaluation program. Presently, that's for single family properties. If your entire complex needed some support, that's where you would take my card and we could schedule a walkthrough. I'm happy to support in those types of ways. On the residential side, presently we're using the Metropolitan Water District's turf rebate removal program, which is presently at $2 a square foot on a residential property. And Ron, did you guys add some money or is that
not yet?
So the funds change. So if you're interested in that as a HOA, obviously I can help you with that process. That's a MET program, but I'm well versed in the program, so I can be a liaison with that. There's a bug up here. And so we're looking into and we're starting the process going out to bid on a high efficient toilet delivery program, which is a little different from a rebate in that you would actually have a toilet delivered to the home. And so we're working out the details on that as far as eligibility. There are some variances with HOAs, single family residential properties and so forth. But keep your eyes on our website for changes to that. Home water use reports and conservation kits. I mentioned those are free of charge you can either go online or we have kit cards available at our office in Torrance just down the hill. Go ahead. On a commercial side, toilets, urinals, clothes washers, and weather-based irrigation controllers. Again, also commercial rotating nozzles, spray body with integrated pressure regs, and check valves. This is something that your, I would presume that your sites have a either an on-site gardener or landscape company. I'm happy to talk to them as well. I do a lot of presentations for the landscape industry. We have free sprinkler nozzles that are available to the entire site. And then this turf replacement program, as mentioned, that's through the Met affiliation. They are running that program presently. We have it in here because we have several districts that are not in the Metropolitan Water District territory, and so they are taking advantage of a Cal Water turf removal program. So as mentioned, we do have a dedicated call center. That's the number there. And I already am thrilled to announce that we have regional conservation coordinators supporting. So where I used to travel half of the state, I now have some folks that are internal helping me throughout this process, so I'm a little bit more available. Okay. And we did already make changes. We had to, you know, I started out the slides with the fact that things started on April 1st. Well, we've made a lot of changes to our billing system. We've added team members all in the last, 2.5 months. It's been quite a journey for us. And so we've got a lot of resources available on our drought page. I would encourage anybody to take a look at that. And there's a lot of reading material. Again, the water shortage contingency plan is available there. And then we've got fact sheets and tips and information that we've been mailing out to the homes. And that phone number is our call center right down in Torrance, and the email address is for questions if you'd like to ask or give us a call. And that is it.
Yep, thank you. We've got one more quick speaker, and then we'll be answering all the questions that you guys have been writing down on cards. So I'm going to keep coming around collecting cards. Thank you. And Sherry Rep Lodesman from the city is going to come talk about what the city's been doing, just about 5 minutes, about, you know, from a city point of view on their own lands and property. One thing I want to clarify, because you guys might be confused, and I think Cal Water probably doesn't realize necessarily how we're organized. Our homeowners associations here in Palos Verdes estates are not quite like as you're thinking of them. We are 501c4s, and we are voluntary organizations. We're considered civic benefit organizations. We're more educationally based, and we also at times try to influence or represent ourselves to the city, but we are not interdependent. Each property is its own property. There is no property manager. There is no uniform. Yeah, so we are a conduit for information and for advocacy for things that make sense for our particular geography. Okay. But that's what we do. So, okay, Sherry, thank you. And I'll collect these.
All right, well, good evening. Well, I have to tell you, the Cal Water website and the Cal Water phone number is important for you to know. One, I had to call it just 2 hours ago because I got a call from my husband saying he accidentally broke the water line coming into our house. So he was absolutely panicked, as was I, because I'm, you know, over here, not at home. But Cal Water was very responsive, so they were able to come and help turn off the water. We'll get it fixed. Hopefully by tomorrow I'll still be able to shower and look presentable. So, but it is a reminder that there's information always available to you. Through Cal Water specifically, but there's lots of other organizations. And I know it's often difficult to know who to reach, so you can always contact the city. We have information available on our website, which is very useful. And hopefully you've all just received your newsletter. Everybody nodding yes? There's a lot of information in the newsletter. So we're helping to remind you of some of the requirements that Susan just summarized. And there's also some contacts in terms of websites available through this article as well. Another thing you can do, and I think we have these available just outside the door, is you can fill out one of these forms, and we'll be happy to put you on our e-blast. So when there's newsletters, when there's information that we just think you should know about, or if you're interested in council, planning commission, any of our other committees, fill one of these out. We'll be happy to put you on the list. Other things that we do, you may periodically see some of our staff driving around the city, the white trucks with the guys with the nice orange shirts. They will sometimes help you when you don't even know they're helping you. Just the other day, we found lots of water running down the street. We knocked on the door. Nobody was home. Turns out that their irrigation system had broken, and it was just flowing into the street. There was nobody there to help them. So one of our staff, even though it's kind of above and beyond, you know, the call of duty, went into the backyard and turned everything off, left a card on the door, and then immediately called Cal Water because we wanted them to know that the water was turned off too. So you may sometimes see us helping you directly, and other times we may be helping you in a way that you may not want because you may have that water running down the street because you're just not paying attention. You may have one of our code enforcement officers come pay you a visit and ask you to please be a little bit more mindful. We're not there to regulate what Cal Water is doing, but we do have our own codes that require runoff not to come into our streets. So there are some things that overlap. But in most cases, we'll remind you of Cal Water's regulations so that you don't run afoul either by getting lots of charges on your bill or ultimately having a restrictor put onto your property. Another area that we will become more and more involved with is on landscape design. If you're building a new home, you will be subject to landscape requirements that are already in place, but we expect those to be significantly updated through the state of California. And we expect that they'll either reduce or eliminate the ability to have turf in new homes. We certainly encourage those who already have a lot of turf. It's a great time to get rid of a lot of it. There's some rebates available, but it's just the right thing in terms of water use. We're also working very collaboratively with Cal Water, West Basin, and the Palos Verdes Golf Club in trying to get recycled water available to the peninsula. Unfortunately, you know, it's very difficult to get recycled water here. It's really only going to come up to the hill and serve areas of Torrance and primarily the golf course. But it is a great partnership. We've actually applied for a $2.6 million grant. That was what the commissioner was referring to in terms of the Palos Verdes Estates contribution. It's really not our contribution. We filled out the grant application. We don't have that money to be able to spend on the water, unfortunately. But we are looking for $3.1 million from the West Basin and also potentially $1.6 million from Cal Water. And cobbling all those sources together, hopefully within the next year to 2 years, we'll actually have recycled water available to the golf course. There's two projects that are actually being proposed. One is to water the golf course itself. It's the jewel. We always want to keep it green if we can. But we have a secondary benefit, which is a dunes restoration project. It's a small area, about 0.85 acres, but we'll be utilizing, kind of as a mitigation for the construction, the ability to remove some of the invasives and allow for native habitat restoration. So watch for that over the next year or two, and hopefully we'll have a real good success with it. One other thing I wanted to mention is what we're doing for our own water use, because we are a customer just like you are. So Cal Water comes knocking on our door and says 36% reduction. We have to figure it out. And it's a little bit more difficult for us because we have lots of locations where we're using water. Obviously, we have buildings. There's not a lot we can do about the buildings other than the standard things that everybody would use in terms of restrictors on the faucets and such. But within the landscape, we've realized that we've inherited a lot of old landscape design. There's a lot of turf that is not necessarily being used for park purposes. So we are looking for reduction and removal of that turf. The first area Susan already identified is when you drive into the city and you see some of our medians, we've already turned the water off. And it's not because we wanted to, we're actually mandated by the governor's directive. So if it's a decorative landscaped area that's for turf, we don't have a choice, it's not recreation. So Paseo Leonardo, the triangle, the small grass area that's right in front of City Hall, we've already turned those off. And we have to start turning off more. We'll be working with the Parklands Committee. We'll be reaching out to various homeowners groups and residents to try to get ideas of what we can do. But we know that there's probably at least another 12 to 13 locations that really are just decorative. They're not being used for our kids and others to play. So we're going to have to do the right thing and slowly start turning off more and more water until we can get to that 36%. But it's a collaborative effort. We're going to be working in partnership with all of you. So we're hoping to come up with good ideas so that we can show good stewardship, good leadership in how we can turn this landscaping around to still maintain a very attractive community, but one that's a little bit more thrifty in the water. So that, I think, covers everything that I wanted to talk about. So I'm going to pass it back over to Jill.
Thank you.
we're going to have the panel all come up. The panel, meaning the speakers who just spoke, are all going to come up here. Reggie has put together your questions, and he is now going to ask the panelists to answer them. So there are a lot of questions. I'd say several dozen at least. So we'll hopefully get through all of them.
Who says you get the gavel?
Uh-oh, maybe I'll move that.
I wanted that.
Okay, so we have, as Jill said, we have quite a few questions, and not surprisingly, Susan wins.
Testing.
Okay, so let me start off by, there were several questions that were sort of alarming, and this will give you an opportunity to address some of the alarming rumors that are going around. So one rumor was that Cal Water was going to shut off water for those who are wasting water. You addressed that, but maybe you can talk a little bit about under what conditions things would happen.
So that would be the ultimate. You know, we would have had to have gone out to that person or that business home on several occasions. That would basically be that person is or business is egregiously wasting water. And I just don't see it happening. I mean, I see Cal Water as helping to educate and communicate, and that is precisely why we have added to our group of knowledgeable employees to go out and to reach out to these folks.
Okay. So there are a number of questions, and we'll get to those in a little bit later, but addressing hardship cases. And so there's going to be conditions where people are just not going to be able to hit their target. So one of the questions is there a criteria where a consistent nonconformance of the allocation would result in additional fines or restrictions, flow restrictors and things like that, where they aren't associated with waste, but just not being able to meet an allocation for various reasons?
Right. And those reasons could be shared with us via the appeals process, and we will be able to, we have consumption information, and as much information that the public or an individual person that's going through a challenging time, we're concerned about that, and we want to be able to listen to their concerns via the appeal process, and we will be, you know, working with people.
Okay, so we have several questions that talk about assuming the exceedances are not egregious, it's just not being able to meet the allocation, what is the penalty? Is it strictly the additional cost per CCF of the amount of water used over the allocation, or are there other penalties?
That's correct. Yes.
So specifically the answer to the question is, if you go over your budget but not in an egregious fashion, it would be the $10 per CCF.
That is correct.
In excess of
not
your allocation.
Not to exceed, yes.
And someone asked if you did go over your budget and you were over consistently, will the penalties get more dramatic? And I believe you're saying the answer is no at this point.
The answer is no. Yes.
Okay.
Sorry. Anna White.
So there's for those in the audience that aren't engineers, can you describe what a CCF is?
Sure. It's 100 cubic feet of water, and one CCF is equal to 748 gallons of water.
Right. So the question is what's a wash load? A wash load is maybe a few gallons, and so that's hundredths of a CCF.
It's going to depend on, is anybody else on this panel? It's going to depend on the washer, basically. Yeah. You know, as years go on and technology improves, there are high efficient washers out there that can accommodate large loads with a smaller amount of water, and we have those on our rebate list. Ron, do you know the?
I think 20 to 40 gallons, depending on how bad the washing machine is.
Old style?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I think the answer to the person that wrote this question is there may be more than 100 flushes of a toilet in a CCF and tens of wash loads in a CCF. I think folks are just trying to understand what a CCF
sure.
is.
Sure. Well, think about a gallon of milk. you got a gallon of milk, and in you'd have to have 748 of those gallons of milk all spread around for one unit, which, you know, you can take a look at your bill. And
a flush is about a gallon, though?
Yeah, depending on, yeah, on flushing, the toilets that we're rebating, they're presently 1.28 gallons per flush or less, and those are the high, considered high-efficient toilets.
So there was a question about banking. So can you talk again about if you don't use units in a month, how that rolls over?
Sure. Just kind of like a rollover in a cell phone plan, you have the opportunity to bank them for future use. If you run into a month that you've got higher use, you've got that bank that is available. And that would eliminate a surcharge in a month that you had gone over your budget.
There's a question, the minimum is 6 CCFs as an allocation. Can you bank, if you get below 6 CCFs, you can still bank the amount that you're under?
So it all depends on your budget. So if you are under your budget and you have not used a unit or two or whatever the amount is, that goes into your bank.
Yeah, I think the confusion here is the questioner thought that you don't actually measure less than 6 CCFs. You do measure less than 6 CCFs, and if your allocation is 6 and you only use 4, you can bank the 2.
That is correct. It's not retroactive, though. It's all going forward.
Okay. We're going to actually throw some to Ron because he's sitting there looking like he doesn't have anything to do. There was a question about desalination. You talked a little bit about it, but is there anything else you can say about it?
Sure. We've been researching ocean water desal since 2002. We built a full-scale demonstration facility at Sea Lab in Redondo Beach. We've done 17 studies, primarily to find out how to save energy, reduce costs, and protect the environment. The wedge wire screen is a very effective system. We're also studying sub-ocean floor withdrawal, and we're looking at a 20 and possibly a regional 60 million gallon a day plant. And our board last week gave the go-ahead to do an environmental impact report.
Yeah, so the questioner asked, shouldn't long-term plans and development begin now? And your answer is, it has.
They have been.
the reclaimed water that you talked about, that's for the golf course use. None of that would be used for human consumption?
Not right now, no. But we do produce about 12 million gallons a day that is injected along the coast to keep the ocean from coming in and contaminating our well water.
There's a question about collecting rainwater. And the actual question are there penalties for collecting rainwater, or is it encouraged?
Highly encouraged. Mm-hmm. West Basin has had you need rain, of course. I hear the chuckles and the
minor
giggles.
Point.
Yes, of course, we all know that. But West Basin has had, on occasion, rain barrel giveaways, and I myself got, I'm a customer of Cal Water in Redondo Beach, and I got 2 rain barrels, and I'm waiting for the rain.
And if you want to go to Metz, bewaterwise.com, as long as you buy a rain barrel that costs less than $75, you get that totally reimbursed, and you can do that right now.
We actually have a question for Sherry. With the increased fire danger, how is the city dealing with the parkland water needs?
Well, the parklands are not irrigated at this point, but we are concerned when we see drier and drier conditions, because if we do have a fire, it could spread really quickly. What the City Council has done is they've actually allocated some additional funds towards the removal of dead and or brush that's within the parklands area. We're calling that our Enhanced Fire Safety and Weed Abatement Program. So we do an annual program where we try to clear things, you know, within about 100 feet of all the properties. This enhanced program will allow us to go deeper into some of those canyons, a little bit farther up those hillsides. As an example, if you're familiar with Solano Canyon, which is up in the Valmonte area, that's one of the areas we'll be looking to do. Also, the Torrance Boundary Trail, where we have all those eucalyptus, That's another area. But over in the Lenawda Bay, you know, further up the hillside, maybe up towards, there's several canyons through there actually that can probably all use the help. Within this year and next year, we'll be doing those projects.
Okay. I mentioned that there are a number of questions having to do with hardship cases relative to the allocation. So what I was going to suggest that I do is I mention a couple, and if you have some thoughts, you can maybe respond to some of these. So one is, my wife and I are both handicapped. Can I get some relief from the restrictions?
Absolutely. We are concerned with folks that don't fall into, you know, the category. There are changes in our homes and in our health, and we would encourage you to share that with us. Share the information as to, through the appeal process, as to what your needs are so that we can discuss it and appropriately respond.
In a similar vein, we have cases where 2 years ago in 2013, when the allocations are what the allocations are based on, mm-hmm. there were two people living in the house and now there's five.
Right. So that's another excellent example. And if anybody wants to chat with myself or Dana after the meeting, we will make ourselves available. And, you know, sometimes things like that don't really want to talk about in front of everybody. So we'd be happy to stick around.
Okay. And again, PVE has been a second home. If people move back here, again, the water use would go up. And is that something that would be an appealable issue?
That's really an individual. We'd have to look at the individual budget, you know, what the water use was in 2013. You know, we would need more information before I could answer that one.
Okay. There are a couple of cards here, actually three, where the author of the questions are sort of looking at what they've done in the past, and they don't understand how they can go any further. So they've already replaced all their appliances, reduced the sprinkler timing, or reduced the lawn entirely, and they're not seeing where they're going to get there. Is there something we can help them with?
Absolutely. I think that would be another good example for the appeal process, especially to be as detailed as you possibly can for all of the actions that you've taken to help conserve over the years. That's definitely something that we would like to hear about as well.
So part of that answer also is one that I'll throw out to Marlene. So for example, there's a question here. How can you tell if your lawn needs more water or less water?
You know what? Everybody's lawn could use less water. The classic thing is you go and you know, your gardener has turned it way up because he wants your grass to look nice and green. I think we can probably compromise a little bit and go for a grass that's not quite as green and use less water. Let it grow longer. Let it grow to about 4 inches and keep the thatch when you mow it and don't fertilize it as much. So your grass will live on with a lot less water.
You can read the meter down to a tenth of a CCF. However, our system does not have the capability to register that usage on your bill. So we can't break down your per CCF charge into a tenth of a CCF. So as a customer, if you want to monitor your usage, which we do encourage customers to do so weekly, because we can only monitor it monthly when we do your meter read, you're definitely encouraged, and you can look at that tenth of a CCF from day to day and see how that changes and monitor it yourself as well.
But there's no plans right now for Cal Water to actually read it and report it to a tenth of a CCF, nor is there a plan. I think I have asked this question before. There's no plan right now to do electronic metering where you can do a daily monitoring of the water usage.
Well, it's definitely something that we're always considering. We like to stay on top of technology. It's actually something that was I had actually addressed a customer about just recently. We do have pilot programs going all the time. If we do see that it's something that would be beneficial, it is something that we would like to put out on a larger scale. Currently, there is a pilot program with digital read meters in the Torrance area. And it's just in a fraction of our district, and it was giving us some problems, so we definitely didn't want to introduce it to all of our public. until all of those bugs have been worked out. So we're always trying new things, and we definitely want to make things easier for the customers, which in turn would make things a little bit easier for us to help you as well. So we are always looking at new technology. So it's definitely something to keep in the back of your minds that we are looking for newer ways to help you.
Let me follow that up with another question, and I don't remember whether Susan mentioned it, but I believe Cal Water has a program where you could request someone to come out to your house and do an inspection of your home and make recommendations on water usage, and at the same time, could that person come out and show the resident where their water meter is, how to get to it, and how to read it?
Absolutely. We have a newly launched residential water use evaluation program, and they would... we have a contractor for that program, and they go into the home, evaluate the water use both indoors and outdoors, and as a side note, could show folks where their meter is. Absolutely.
We have a question about the watering days. Why can none of the even or odd-numbered PVE addresses water landscape on Mondays? I'm not quite sure what that means.
That's a good question that I don't have the answer to, actually, why Mondays was disallowed, but I'd be happy to get back with your group on that. Absolutely.
Another question, and actually either you or Ron, is it more efficient from a water conservation perspective to hand wash dishes, especially including the wait time for the water to get hot, or washing a full load in a high efficiency dishwasher more efficient?
Let me start and then you can kick in. I think we're telling everybody to do a full load of dishes, but I've also read that if you just fill the sink and have one for washing and one for rinsing, that is also very effective.
I'm going to concur with Ron.
I get a point, yes. Thank you.
Dana, what do you think? Didn't we get one of those questions come in to the office?
We did. That info rd@calwater.com. You can send your questions there. If you don't get all of your questions answered tonight, feel free to send them there. We can answer them online as well. But yes, that was a question that was brought up. Something important to remember is always use a full load. When the asker mentioned waiting for the water to warm up, that's a perfect situation for you to use hand washing. You can use that cooler water to fill up the rinse side, and then once it gets warm, move it over to the wash side, and then even go a step further and take that rinse water that's not as contaminated with the soap, unless you're using like a biodegradable soap, take that outside and water the plants now too. So there are ways that you can do it. If you have a high efficiency fixture, then you're already doing great if you're using the machine and you're using full load. So it's I think it's 6 one way and half a dozen another, just depending on your habits in the home.
Thanks. So you're not allowed to, we have two questions here that are the same. You're not allowed to hose down your driveway with a hose and a nozzle, but are you allowed to use a pressure washer since it uses less water?
It's disallowed. It's still hosing.
This is a question for Susan. Who keeps track of banking the water?
We are doing that through our internal process.
And this is really, I'm not quite sure who to give this question to, is what if your yard is sloped to the street and the water, when you water your lawn or whatever, yard you have, the water will just run downhill and off into the street. How do you keep from violating the water runoff criteria? Sir?
Well, actually, we're probably talking about the right-of-way.
Probably a combination of both.
Right? Yeah, and so, we have had some discussion about these types of issues.
There's probably a couple of things that can be done. One is, first you look at your irrigation and whether or not you're overwatering. You still may have too much spray going on, and it's just not being able to percolate going into the ground. Secondly, is it may be the type of plant materials. If you plant something different, it might stay on the property. But you might also have to take a physical alteration. You may have to change the grade just ever so slightly so it doesn't get so much momentum coming down the hill. It is important to make sure that it doesn't reach the street, because not only will you have problems with Cal Water, but you potentially have problems with the city. So there's always something you can do. There's always an answer to every question.
Okay, thank you.
Oftentimes, it's the irrigation design that of the irrigation system, because a lot of them were designed so many years ago.
Right.
So that's very key. I agree with you.
And that's something Marlene might want to touch on, because I think some of the older irrigation systems, sometimes they're on too long, or they just have too much spray where it concentrates too much.
Correct. In fact, probably the first thing you want to do when you're looking at reducing the water on your landscaping is to do a thorough evaluation of your spray and to find out if it's covering where it should, if it's not, if you're overspraying, and adjust things accordingly. There are a lot of new products out on the lot out now that are much more efficient and get the water where it's usable rather than just spraying into the wind or spraying into the street.
I had this question in Ron's pile, but actually I know Sherry's been working this issue, and the question is, will the pump station have capacity beyond the golf course?
It will, and what's the question is referring to is how many cubic feet of water will be brought up with this recycled project. The golf course itself takes about 200 cubic feet of water per year or per month, whatever the number is. There's only about 15 or 20 that's left over. And unfortunately, we can't bring more capacity up because there's only an 8-inch line that's at the South High School, so we can only extend it by an 8-inch line. If they had a larger line, we could bring more water up. I think as will probably be expressed by West Basin, we almost have an infinite amount of water that can be recycled if we have the technology for recycled, for cleaning it. But it's a matter of the delivery, and that's sometimes where the complications are.
Okay, this is a question for Susan. You mentioned programs for residents and for commercial. Are there any programs for municipalities, so for to help Sherry out?
That's a great question,
please,
yes.
Please.
And the city is eligible for everything that we talked about on a commercial standpoint. So I've already worked with the city on several occasions. And I don't know his title, but he has my direct cell number. And
on speed dial.
Sorry?
He has it on speed dial.
Yes, and I definitely get calls, and which is great. I've been on a ride-along with Alec, and we've been all over to the parks and public right-of-way, all sorts of stuff. So, yes, the cities are all eligible here on the Hill for all of our programs, as well as the schools. You know, I've got a presentation this week for the Palos Verdes Unified School District, Palos Verdes Peninsula Unified School District, and so we're looking at every opportunity to share our programs and information with everybody.
Great. Here's a question, again, getting back to hardship case. I think there was something in the presentation that says that you can't fill a swimming pool, and the question here is can you get approval to refill a pool for safety reasons? Are there any exceptions where you'd be able to refill a pool?
Well, do you have any ordinances? Tell a little bit from the city on if you have an ordinance, and then I can address Cal Water.
Yeah, typically from the city's perspective, if your pool has already gone dry and you leave it dry, we don't necessarily have any requirements.
Okay.
So I think it's more a Cal Water requirement in terms of the ability to refill.
Sure. And that is a good question, because we started out with our water shortage contingency plan, and the way we submitted it to the California Public Utilities Commission, it actually did have a Cal Water prohibited use of water for the refilling of a swimming pool. We've since pulled that from the prohibited uses of water. So it is no longer a prohibited use of water. Although, of course, a swimming pool is, you know, a large body of water in someone's yard, I would not want to see anybody wasting that water. If you do have to fill it up, if you've had construction work on it or what have you, and you do have to fill it up, keep in mind that you would have to do so within your budget for that particular month.
Sounds expensive.
Yeah.
So you could plan, in bringing that up, you could plan for the, if you've, you know, you've got X amount banked for several months in a row, you could, that sixth month maybe, you could use that banked water if you expect to be filling your pool at that time.
Okay, here's a challenge, Ron. The questioner asked, how do we reduce our dependence on imported water from Northern California from the Colorado River from 66% to 33% by 2020?
Okay, that's what our program's all about. We'll be trying to double our recycling, double our conservation, and when the time is right, use ocean water desal to diversify our supply. And we're on track, probably not to get that done by 2020, but the board will probably extend that to a different year. But that's the goal.
So this is a question for anybody on the panel. Do you think people are conserving as much water as possible?
I would say no. I would say we all could do a little bit more. And I say that because I've done that. In the last couple of months, I swapped out all the toilets. I added a pool cover. I brought somebody in to adjust my sprinklers. And I was running off a little bit into the driveway, just reducing the flow, stopped that. Faucet aerators, shower heads. In fact, I bought a shower head from South Bay Environmental Services Center and installed it. You can do a little bit more. And when everybody does a little bit more, we're going to have a great, huge response.
You know, if I can just state, you know, on behalf of what we've seen here in Palos Verdes Estates, there are some residents who are doing a great job. We see lawns that are being replaced. We see irrigation that's being changed. But then there are other residents who frankly think they can buy their way out of it. And while I appreciate that Cal Water is allowing people to pay, I guess, these overages, these surcharges, in reality, people have to take more responsibility, and they have to do the right thing by reducing the irrigation that they're using. Most of the water that we see in Palos Verdes Estates is being used for irrigation. It's not what you're using for drinking or to wash your dishes. So residents ultimately have to show a little bit more responsibility. So we hope that all of you that are here tonight, you're obviously part of the solution because you're paying attention, you're trying to get information, but it's all the other residents that we have within the community. We need to get the word out to them so that hopefully, ultimately, all of us start doing a lot more for reduction.
Well said, both of you.
Thank you.
So I think one last question here, and it's for Susan. And I think there's some confusion as to how the allocations were actually computed. So maybe you could go through that again. The question is, how was the number of people allocated per home, and is this information on our bill?
Sure, thank you. That is a good question. The census was utilized throughout as an analysis tool throughout all of our districts in the state of California, which is, so each particular district has a different census number, so it was an average. Now that's where the appeals process would come into play if you are not the average and you have certain situation, you know, you have more people in your home than the district average is. And so that those averages are on our website, aren't they? Yep.
Okay, yes.
The question is related to artificial turf, whether or not you can replace your turf with artificial grass. And it's a little bit complicated of a question, because from the city's perspective, we have no problem with that. But you do need to check with the Homes Association, because they're also reviewing your landscape plans. And my understanding from the Homes Association is that they don't have concern if it's in the backyard, but if it's in your front yard, I think they're going to be a little bit more particular about the type and how it's placed, just to make sure it doesn't look too unusual. You know, I've gone through neighborhoods where, you know, you see natural grass and all of a sudden you see something that's bright green. It obviously doesn't fit. So I think you have to be a little bit careful with how you use the artificial grass. There's so many other alternatives to look at as well. One of the things I just want to mention briefly is that the city has a requirement right now for a maximum of 65% hardscape. That includes your building, your sidewalks, all of that. The Planning Commission and City Council are interested in possibly increasing that, because we realize that the solution's not always having landscaping. It's about having other features that still make your property usable.
So let me add to that. Jill and I did talk to Dale Hoffman, who's on the board of the Homes Association, and he went to a meeting with the art jury, and he brought the issue up of being able to relax some of the criteria that the art jury is historically held to. Nothing has come of it yet, but at least the dialogue has started. And so if you have suggestions or questions specifically, send it to us, and we'll have Dale bring it to the art jury.
Actually, it's a very common issue. She's asking about the sewer lines breaking because of roots searching for water. We have a lot of older homes that have the clay pipe, and that's very susceptible to that situation. And the newer ones that are the plastic pipe don't have the same issue. There's also... it is plastic, because there is also a way that they come in and... how do you say, they extrude a lining inside it to keep the roots out. But
just to be clear, though, I think the question has to do with the sewer line, which doesn't really affect your water consumption.
It was the main water line. It was the water line that goes to the sprinklers. So I don't know if it's sewer
or whatever. Oh, the sprinkler line. Yeah, that happens. They break from time to time. Yeah, no, that it happens. Actually, it's happened in my house 3 times already. Yeah.
How does that affect your water?
Well, it goes up because the water's leaking.
Believe me, I'll find that out today, because that's what happened at my house. It was an irrigation line that broke. So I'm hoping it's not too much damage. But I think the lesson learned, though, is that you have to always monitor both your irrigation and any water use that you have within the property, because you're prone to breakage, especially when you start having older lines. You know, if you have a landscape architect or a landscape, you know, maintenance crew that comes to your property, you know, just periodically checking things to see if they're starting to get old, maybe it's time to upgrade and replace. Because when you have an issue, it gets really costly, so it's probably best to be preventative if you can.
There are other ways to address, if you're talking about the plastic, the white plastic water line for your sprinklers, sometimes those are susceptible to surges in pressure, and so you might want to talk to somebody about putting in a pressure regulator. Well, no, I'm talking about within the water line itself, putting in a pressure regulator to prevent pressure surges from breaking the plastic.
What did we find out of our 2013 allocation?
Can you repeat the question?
Sure. She was asking where to find out where the 2013 water usage, it is on the bill. So if you're receiving, if you're in a single family residential property and you're getting one bill, you should see it on your bill. We started placing those on the bills effective June 1st. Oh, and you can see it online as well, yes. But it is on the bill as well.
I've read that there's more and more concern that with increasing use of desalination, the rising concentration of salt in the oceans is going to have serious negative effects on the ocean wildlife. Is there anything being done to prevent that from happening?
I will take a little bit of that, if you don't mind. First of all, the ocean is rising. As you know, with climate change, the glaciers are actually putting more fresh water into the ocean. And so ocean water desal is such a small scale effort compared to the overall ocean size. I don't think that would be a problem. There's actually valleys in the Atlantic Ocean that if you stacked the Rockies, the Himalayas, and another mountain on top, you wouldn't reach the surface of the ocean. So, good point, but I don't think ocean water desal, as it's, you know, feasible now, would not impact the ocean at all.
If there were not a golf course, would you still construct a pump station?
The question is whether or not the recycled water would still be brought to the peninsula if we didn't have a golf course. The answer probably would be yes, but maybe not now. Right now, we happen to have a very large project where we were able to create partnership between the city, the golf course, West Basin, and Cal Water. So we're able to put together the funds necessary. If it was just done for residential, it probably wouldn't happen anytime soon because of the cost of taking the water lines to each one of your properties. That would be wildly expensive. So taking it to one location, we can do it.
Okay, I had promised Ron we would be done by 8:30, and we didn't quite make it, but wanted to thank everybody that did come, and keep in mind that we're here to listen to any comments that you have in the future, so let us know. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you very much.